us online today.
My name is Pete. This is Repeat. We got the same skirts on.
Great minds think alike here at The Lift. But we are so glad that you are with us. My real name is Allie. This is Caroline. And we just want to give you a warm welcome. Type in down below. Let us know where you're watching from. We would love to know where you're tuning in from.
Yes. And if we have not yet met, just go ahead and scan the QR code below. It will take you to a
digital connection card.
Yeah, it'll take you to a page where you can say your name, all that stuff, so we can get to know you.
Yes, and this weekend, you guys, we have been celebrating The Lift's 15th year anniversary. It has been a whole birthday party here. Yesterday, we had two services, and the Lord was so present in both services and our time of gathering in between the services. 9:30, the Lord was present, and we are expectant and excited for the 11 o'clock service today. So you're going to be so excited. Make sure you get out your notes. You're going to want to write down what we're learning about today, and worship is just so good. We've got some throwbacks, so yes, it's going to be amazing. Yes. So, another thing to note, friends, next week we have a change in our scheduling. There's no more 9:30 service. Instead, it's 9:15. So if you sometimes will tune in to our 9:30 service, put a reminder on your phone. It is 9:15. If you tune in at 9:30, you're going to miss
the music. Yeah.
You'll miss it. So you can tune in earlier, or if you're with the 11 o'clock and that just kind of works for you, 11 o'clock is staying the same. So be excited for that next week. We are so excited.
Yes. Yes. So we are excited, as she said. Stay tuned and hear a great message from Pastor Lance, and we will see you later.
See ya.
How you doing, guys? Hello and welcome to The Lift.
Your love won't deny me. Even in the storm you find me. You call me from the darkness to your light. Your hand ever leads me. You love you, you're never gonna leave me. You're teaching me to fight a better fight. Oh yeah. Let your glory shine. Let your glory shine. Testimony this morning. And now you're living inside my heart, and you gave me a brand new start. Thank you, Lord. We'll never be forced apart.
Come on, y'all, help us out. Hope is rising, sing it.
Hope is rising, hearts are waking, love unfailing, never changing. Hear the sound, the chains are breaking. Start up the party, 'cause you have rescued me. Now I'm living, I can't stop dancing, 'cause you have set me free. Raise up,
come on, sing it again. You've rescued me,
and you have rescued me. Now I'm living, I can't stop dancing, 'cause you have set me free. Raise the music, let's start.
Yeah. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher.
Come on, how many of you in this place believe you've been changed by the love of Jesus?
Rains now and forever. He rains now and forever. God arise.
I'm ready to celebrate Jesus today. Do me a favor, take a seat, check out this video.
Hey, what's going on, guys? It's your friend, your brother, your family, Trey Simon. I just want to say happy birthday to The Lift, 15 years of ministry. I love all of you guys. I'm hoping that I get to see you again very soon. Have a great time and happy birthday.
Man, happy 15th birthday. I hope that God just continues to do amazing things through your ministry and through your team and through the people that have come through those doors. I know that you guys have meant a very special, been a very big part of my life in ministry and in leading worship. And I thank you so much for always having me and loving me with open arms. Here's to another 15. Love you guys.
What's up, Lift family? It's Darrell Comedy, and I'm here to congratulate you on celebrating 15 years of seeing God do what he does best, and that's impossible things. You've seen 15 years of professions of faith, 15 years of baptisms, 15 years of mission trips and L groups getting started and worship nights and prayer meetings. You survived a pandemic, and you not only survived, but you came out on top, and now you're thriving, and this is the best part about today. You're just getting started, and I am so excited to see what God is going to do in your lives as you continue to entrust this ministry into his care. I'm bummed that me and my family couldn't be there to celebrate with you all, but we are still praying, we are still believing, and we are still loving on our Lift family. God bless you guys. Have an incredible time celebrating, and I can't wait to come back and worship with y'all. Love you guys.
All right.
Yeah. Happy birthday, Lift. Welcome to church, everybody. Yeah, they look good, don't they?
They do.
They look really good. Welcome to church. 15 years, can you believe it? 15 years.
Yes.
How many, I want to ask you, right before the curtain dropped, there was a video playing of where we used to, for years, we used to have to set up the Lift every week in the FLC right behind you. How many of you used to attend the Lift back when we did that? A lot of you, and then others of you are thinking, what is that video for? That was what we used to do. Okay, now we have a permanent home here, and so we're so thankful that we don't have to do that. So thankful. Yes. So if you're new here, if you're a guest, hey, we want to get to know you, and so you're going to notice there's a QR code on the screen. Please take a moment right now, if you will. Scan that, will you? Scan that QR code. It's going to take you to a place where you can fill out our connection card. It's a way for us to get to know you and for you to get to know us. Those of you that are watching on the other side of a screen, welcome to the Lift. You can do the exact same thing, okay? Just scan the QR code right below me and just, you know, let us know who you are, okay? Who's watching? We're here for you. And it's going to be a great day, right?
Listen, I was just thinking, Lance. We both started as youth pastors, and when we were going through those songs there, I felt like I was back in my youth days. Yeah. I don't know about you.
Well,
but
they were probably wondering, the music's a little bit strange, right?
Yes. But
those were like, what, the last seven?
The classics.
Those were the classics, okay, for the past 15 years. Those were seven songs that were on they were at the top of the charts, right?
Yeah. So, also, I noticed no one had to look at the screens. I mean, we knew the words, everything. So
a lot
let's
of people,
go.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a couple of guests. Come on out here. Come on out here. We have Mr. Jack Bennett. Okay, let me explain this. We got Mr. Mike Blackwood. Mike began with us 15 years ago, and he was our first original worship pastor. And so you can tell he's a little older than Zach. Also, Zach is our longest running worship pastor. You did a little of that too. So worship pastor, 7 years with us, and so we're just thankful to have y'all back.
Yeah, y'all. Thanks for coming.
Hey,
back.
We'll take y'all every week if you want to.
The video that you saw, there were previous worship leaders who have just come in to help us, and people that you know and love, and they wish they could have been here. They were all trying to come, and those three could not. So anyway.
All right, we ready to pray?
I think we got one more thing. One more thing. And this, you know, this doesn't really apply to you guys, but I will let you know next week, very important that you understand this, there's a time change. A time change that's going to happen next Sunday. Next Sunday, we are going to start a new time, 9:15, okay? So if you bounce back and forth from the 11 o'clock to the 9:30 service, don't show up at 9:30 starting next week. Show up at 9:15. It's very important, right? One of the things that we're trying to do is help the parking. I know that when you guys get here, it's a little crazy as the 9:30 service is leaving. You're trying to come on the campus. So what we're doing is we're going to create some space in between those two services. Hopefully the campus will be clear where you can, you know, more easily park. All right, I think that would probably be something you would enjoy. So next week, that starts next week, new service times, 9:15 and 11 o'clock, and we're ready to continue with the service. So why don't you pray us out?
Let me pray for us. Yeah. Before I do that, let me just rejoice with you guys, with us, that last night 7 people were saved. That was last night. And we know that several were saved this morning, and we'll give you the total at the end of the day. But we're so thankful that you invited your guests, your friends. We're so thankful that you're here with us. And what a wonderful celebration of what God is doing. So let's pray together. Father, just thank you so much for your love for us. Thank you for a church that loves people. Thank you for a group of people who love people. And Lord, I pray that you continue to bless. The best is yet to come. We know that, God, and we want to keep serving you and sharing the gospel with those around us. So, Lord, we just pray that you'll bless our offering today. I pray that you'll bless each and every person here. I pray that the Holy Spirit will guide and direct us in all that we do in this service. And we pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Would you stand together? And let's sing it out this morning. Remember those walls we call sin and shame? Lift it up.
Remember those walls that we called sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Yes, they are.
Remember those giants singing.
Remember those giants we called death and grave. They were like mountains. They were like mountains that stood in our way. But he came and he died and he rose. And those giants are dead now.
Aren't you thankful?
Yes.
Come on, sing. This is our God.
And this is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. And this is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus.
Yes, King Jesus.
Remember that fear that took our breath away. A faith so weak that we could barely. Every word, every whisper.
Now those are.
Now those altars in the wilderness.
They tell the story.
They tell the story of his faithfulness.
Never
once did he fail, and he never will.
This is our God.
And this is our God. This is who he is.
Nobody but Jesus.
And who rescued
me?
Come on, sing his name, Yahweh.
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 promises of God. Aren't you thankful that He is faithful and He's never failed you? As we continue to sing this morning, we're going to sing of His promises. We can trust His heart because He's tried and He's true. He's never lost a battle. So that gives us everything that we need to sing and worship freely in a room like this. So every voice, come on, let's sing this out together.
God of Abraham, You're the God of covenant, of faithful promises. Time and time again, You have proven You do just what You say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart burn when You speak a word, it will come to pass.
Come on, with one voice we say,
great is Your faithfulness to me. Great is Your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise Your name. Great is Your faithfulness to me.
In this place,
You're God from days to days. Though the earth may pass away, Your word remains the same.
Yes, He does. Yes, He does.
Your history can prove there's nothing You can't do. You're faithful and You're true. Through the storms,
come on, You're saying,
the winds may blow,
I'll remain steadfast and let my
just you and Him. Come on, sing it to the top of your lungs. Say, I put my faith.
sing from the rising of the sun. Everybody, we sing. Sing, great is your faithfulness to. Come on, if you believe Jesus is faithful, give him praise. Come on, like never before, I dare you to open up your mouth and give him thanks for his faithfulness.
Is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations,
amen.
So why would he fail now? He won't. Oh, we thank you, Lord. You'll never fail us, and I've still got. My house was built on. I'm safe with you. I am safe
I know we gotta go. But I can't help feel like there's somebody in this room that you limped in here on your last leg, and you are seriously doubting the faithfulness of Jesus. You might look at us and say, how can y'all sing that with confidence? How can you sing it with faith? Let me let you in on just a little secret. There are broken people up here that struggle with that same thing. Because we're human, we have the same flesh, we bleed the same blood. And because of that truth, we just sing it from a place of weakness. And so if you came in here and you got your arms folded or your hands in your pockets because you said, you know what, I don't believe it, I'm not singing it, I can't open my mouth to utter words that I can't pull myself to believe. Maybe sometimes you got to open your mouth and posture yourself in a way that your heart and mind can just follow. Yeah. That's what faith does. Faith allows you to hope in something that you cannot see. So the one that you cannot see, that you live for, can work for you. So I know we gotta go, and I know Lance gotta preach, but we're gonna be with God right here in this moment, because of the God of Jacob, the God of Abraham and Isaac that I read about, that I serve, that I believe, he has never failed. He has never failed. So no matter what it is, whatever rain has come, whatever wind is blowing in your situation, Jesus holds the victory.
Yes.
Jesus holds the victory. So rain came,
wind blew, my house was built on.
Come on, I'm safe.
It's okay to let the tears fall.
Come on, he knows the hurt. He knows the hang-ups that you have in your heart. Sing, rain came, yeah.
Rain came, wind blew,
my house
was built.
Come on, it doesn't matter what uncertainty you have in your mind. I'm safe. You're safe in his arms.
I'm gonna make it.
Come on, let hope come alive. Sing, rain came. You can trust him with your heart. Come on, sing. I'm safe with you.
I'm safe with
you. Come on, y'all, let's go.
You.
Come
on. I'm gonna make
sing,
it.
Rain, come on, baby, take it.
My house was built on. Oh, I'm safe with you.
Just keep singing. Keep singing. Come on. Yeah. Yeah. You believe it? Do you believe it? You're safe. He never fails. He never fails. He never fails. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you that we can walk in this place feeling the weight of the world is on our shoulders, pushing us down, holding us back. And yet we can turn our attention to you and see your bigness and see your greatness. and we thank you for victory through Jesus. I ask you to please do what it is that I cannot. Please lift the head of the discouraged and heal the brokenhearted. That's what you specialize in. For 15 years, we've watched you do it, Lord. And we pray you continue to do it. As we open up your word, do what it is that I cannot, speak to hearts, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, celebrate Jesus. Will you do that? Come on. Come on. Man, come on. Worship team, y'all, thank you. Four services, amazing, amazing. Mike Blackwood, Zach Bennett, thank you for being a part. Thank you for coming and just spending your time here with us at the Lift. Wow. 15 years. 15 years. I was trying to think, okay, so what do you say on your, on, you know, like on an anniversary? What do you say? What message do you bring? And the more I prayed about it, the more I heard God just speaking to me. He said, well, why don't you go back to like the first, anniversary. Right? You go back. What did you do then? And I went back and I pulled up the very first anniversary of the Lift. And the moment I saw that sermon, I thought, I'm going to do that one. I'm going to do the very same sermon that I did 1 year in. And so if it's really a bad sermon, so blame 14 year ago preacher Lance, okay? All right, so anyway, I got to looking at the sermon and there's some things that I did. One of the things that I talked about was this movie, and it's probably one of my favorite movies of all times. It was a movie from 1998, and a lot of you young students, you won't remember this, but it's called Saving Private Ryan. Anybody remember Private Ryan? Anybody watch Private Ryan? I love the movie. It just makes me feel patriotic. Like, I love America, you know? And if you've never watched the movie, you should maybe check it out sometime. The movie's really cool. The movie, it picks up back in D-Day, all right? The beaches of Normandy, and back in June 6th of 1944. And the idea behind the movie is there are a group of men, eight men, are sent in, led by Captain John Miller. They're sent in to rescue one Private Ryan, Private James Francis Ryan. The movie, as it transpires, you see the constant wrestling that these eight men have with eight men being sent in to only rescue one. Like, why should we give our life, sacrifice our life for one? James Francis Ryan. He had older brothers, and every one of those brothers were lost in this very same war. And so America was, they were not willing to allow his life to end as well. Didn't want to go and tell a mom that she had lost all of her kids. So they sent in these eight men to rescue him. Now that movie, one of my favorites of all times. When I think about that movie, I think about the message of the gospel. From Genesis to Revelation, God doing everything he can to reconcile and bring his people back to him. I think about the fact that he sent his son to go into battle, not just for one, but for all. And so if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, it's now your turn. It's your turn. Today's title of the message is the same title as it was 14 years ago, and it's called Beautiful Feet. And you'll understand this in just a moment. The text for today is Romans 10. Okay, we're just going to look at a few verses in Romans 10. And the reason that I chose Romans 10 is because of its writer.
I'll set up the context for you for just a moment. Paul, the Apostle Paul, wrote the book of Romans. And so he's kind of one of these guys where I really appreciate him because of the fact that he can relate to all of us, or we can relate to him. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, then he's someone that you can look at and you say, wow, okay, I kind of wouldn't mind being a little bit like him. If you're not a follower of Jesus Christ, then you can look at him as well, because there was a time when Paul was Saul. He didn't follow Jesus. In fact, he was one of those guys that you wouldn't want to be around. When we read the Bible and the Bible introduces Saul to us, in Acts chapter 8, you get a little picture about this man. Just before Acts chapter 8, there's a follower of Jesus. His name is Stephen. And Stephen is put to death for his faith. He's stoned to death. And I want you to read what the very first verse of Acts chapter 8 says about Saul. Okay, this is what it says. It opens up and says this, "And Saul approved of his execution." This is Saul. He persecuted the church. He killed Christians. I love this idea because I see in Saul the bigness of God. Because it's easy for us to look at somebody and think, oh, God could never reach them. But God did. God reached Saul. And he changed his life, and he became Paul. You know, all of us have those kinds of people in our life. All of us have those people that we look at and we think, oh, there's no way that God would ever change them. There's no way that you know, they would ever become a Christian. I don't know about you, but I never had a friend like Saul. We probably couldn't have been friends. But here's the deal. Those are the people we're called to reach. Paul's life was changed. He was changed by Jesus, and he would go through and he would preach salvation through Jesus. And one of his heart was for the Jewish people. The Jewish people, they felt like that they were made right with God because they were Jews, or they followed the law. And I want you to look at just a portion of scripture of what Paul says about them. Beginning in verse 1 of chapter 10 in Romans, he says this, "Dear brothers and sisters, the longing of my heart and my prayer to God is for the people of Israel to be saved. I know what enthusiasm they have for God, but it is misdirected zeal. For they don't understand God's way of making people right with himself. Refusing to accept God's way, they cling to their own way of getting right with God by trying to keep the law. For Christ has already accomplished the purpose for which the law was given. And as a result," I love this last line, it says, "all who believe in him are made right with God." All that believe in Jesus Christ, they're made right with him. Now, the Jews rejected this. They rejected Jesus. But here's the challenge for us, church. Those are the people that we're called to go reach. The people that reject him. You see, we all have a life-changing message. You go down just a few verses, down to verse 15, and look how Paul describes the message that we have. He says this, "As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news." That word preach could be carry or bring. How beautiful are the feet. Now, let me ask you a question real quick. Do you have beautiful feet? Anybody in here have beautiful feet? There's a few hands and some dudes raising your hand. No, put your hand down. No guy's got beautiful feet. Okay. No. It's impossible. Sorry. Feet are just nasty. Can we just go on record and say that? Okay. Feet are absolutely nasty. That's the reason why you cover them with shoes, right? I was reading that this week thinking about Paul and like, did he really mean beautiful feet, the way that he was saying it. Like, you go back to Paul's day, and they didn't have shoes. Like, they had sandals and flip-flops and open toes. Like, they were Jerusalem cruisers, you know? They weren't dunks. And so they're walking around. Their feet are just plumb nasty. So he couldn't have been talking about beautiful feet. What was he talking about? This is what he really meant. He really meant, oh, how beautiful the message that the feet bring. What a beautiful message that we have. The good news of Jesus Christ, the gospel. So let me ask you this question. What message do you bring? What message? What message does your life communicate, or what message do you carry? See, we're always communicating something through the life that we live. And as Christians, we have this life-changing message. I love hearing about life change. All those testimonies that you saw come out, and one way they come out talking about the mess that's in their life, and then they flip it over and they just show how God is just working in them. Man, he came for messed up people. Life change. I was looking at the outline for this week, and I was looking at the points. I'm thinking, Lance, how did you come up with those points? Like, where did you get those? This looks real weird. And then it hit me. I remember. They came from a TV show that I used to watch on Tuesday nights. It was a reality show, reality TV. It was one about weight loss. Anybody remember what it would have been back in 2009? Biggest Loser. We used to love it. Andrew and I, we would go over to friends' houses and we would watch The Biggest Loser every Tuesday night. Come on, you got to go with me here. There's nothing like seeing someone lose 100 pounds. Like, that's life-changing. One particular episode, it was a Super Bowl episode. They brought in Kirk Warner. And Kirk Warner, he made this challenge to the contestants there, and he had three characteristics. He said, look, if you will apply these three characteristics to your life, you can do anything. And I'm like, whoa, that's pretty cool. What are those three characteristics? And when he said them, I thought, you know what? That's really true for the church. Three characteristics. And so that's what I want to bring you today. I want to give you three characteristics that if you will just apply them to your life, it'll change your life. And you know what it'll do? It'll also change other people's lives as well. I'll give you the three characteristics. Here they are. The first one is this: commitment, determination, and faith. Sounds simple, right? Commitment, determination, and faith. Let's talk about commitment for a minute, because it's just a little tricky. When you think about commitment, it's like, it's very complex, because we live in a society where commitment is on like a decline. Think about it. Most anything in life, we're lesser committed, it seems like to me, than we were years ago. Seems like we're lesser committed to relationships, to marriages, to employment, to quality work. We're just lesser committed. If it seems like we're less committed spiritually. I mean, just think about it. The pace of life has challenged our commitment. The Apostle Paul was very committed. And we saw, you might have just overlooked it for a moment, but he was very committed to one thing. And I'm just thinking, man, if we as a church could get back to this one thing, I want to show it to you. It's in verse 1. And this is what he said again: dear brothers and sisters, the longing of my heart and my prayer to God is for the people of Israel to be what? To be saved. He was committed to that. He wanted people to meet the same Jesus that he had met. What would it be like if you and I developed the same conviction that people in our lives needed Jesus? It would change the world. Instead of us looking for ways to be less committed, Like, oh, you know, do I got to go to church today? I think I'm going to give up the serving for a little while. Life groups. Reading my Bible. I mean, like, instead of trying to be less committed, what would it look like if we became more committed to seeing people saved by Jesus? To seeing your friend's life changed. What a characteristic, church, for us to apply to our life. Commitment. Determination is another one. And here's the thing about determination. It's going to take determination to stay committed. You look at the Apostle Paul. He was known for his relentless determination to take the good news throughout Rome. The stuff he faced persecution, he faced danger and obstacles like prison and beatings and stoning. For the average person to go through something like that, it would have been a major setback, but for the Apostle Paul, it was a major setup. It didn't stop him. It didn't deter him. Be determined not to get sidetracked spiritually. Be determined to grow spiritually. You know, we said this year, at the beginning of the year, we said this could be their very best year ever if it's your very best year, what? Spiritually. So be determined to grow spiritually. When we lose our determination, you want to know the very first thing that goes? Our relationship with God. It's like it just gets set on the back burner. And let me tell you something. The moment you set that one on the back burner, a lot of other things start to fall apart. We got to be determined. You have this beautiful message, this life-changing message. And man, if we could just apply this to our life and be determined to carry it out. Be determined not to get sidetracked, not to let the obstacles pull us away. Determination. What a great characteristic to have. And then there's faith. I went back this week and watched this episode. And in this episode, Kirk Warner said to the contestants there, he said, you know, one of the things that you need is you need to have a lot of faith. I thought about this for a moment. I thought, well, yeah. Maybe you do, but for us as Christians, we don't need a lot of faith. We just need about this much faith right here. Let me show you. Faith of a mustard seed. Do you know what's possible with that kind of faith? The Bible says you can move mountains. Imagine us having that kind of faith. Paul's message was one of faith, faith in Jesus Christ. There are some of you walked in and your faith is struggling. Something's happened. Maybe it's weak or you've even lost it. I want to tell you something. Throughout Scripture, the Apostle Paul wrote a good bit of the New Testament. He emphasized throughout the New Testament that God's power and faithfulness is available to all who believe in Jesus Christ. And church, that's the message this world needs to hear. That's the message your friends need to hear, your family members need to hear. That's the message that we have. So think about it. If we could just be committed, have determination and faith, those are the things that make a difference. That's the way you reach people. So let me ask you, knowing that there's always something coming out of your life, what's coming out of yours? Is it beautiful? The Apostle Paul wrote to this young protege of his, Timothy, these words, and I thought, I want to encourage you with these. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, he wrote this. He says, don't let anyone think less of you because you're young. Well, what he's saying to Timothy is don't let people label you. Maybe you're here today or you're watching and there's a label that you keep carrying around. Don't let people label you. Now, what Paul says is be an example to all believers. And what you say and the way you live, in your love, your faith, and your purity. See, we're always communicating something through the life that we live. So church, let's be people who are committed to seeing people saved. Let's be people who are determined not to get sidetracked, not to let obstacles come in and pull us away from our faith or pull us away from our relationship with God. And let's be people of faith. Let's be people who believe that God is faithful and that he can turn our messes into ministry. Last night, I got to see an example of this very thing. Back when we started the lift, back in 2008, one of the guys on the team here, one of the pastors that worked with us, his name was Mike Bell. And Mike, he's actually here. And Mike, I want to say this, and I'm not trying to, I believe this. He was a guy that embodied these characteristics. He was committed, he was determined, and he had faith. There was a restaurant that he and some others from our team kept revisiting. I mean, they just kept going there time and time again. It was a place called Hops. I don't even think it exists anymore, but they kept going back to Hops. And what they did is they built a relationship with a guy named Sean. And so Mike just starts inviting Sean to church, and you know, Sean would turn him down and turn him down and turn him down to eventually one day Sean said, okay, I'm going to come with you to church. And he came to the lift, and here's what happened. He gave his heart and his life to Jesus Christ in 2008. Sean brought his family back last night. Sean was the first wedding, the first marriage that I had ever performed here as the pastor of the lift. I married him and his wife, April. They've got three beautiful children now. Two of their kids have been baptized here at the lift. And his youngest daughter walked into me last night, and she walked right up to me, gave me a hug, looked me in the eye, and said, I'm ready to be baptized. Now, I want to show you a picture of Sean and April. I've got a picture of them. This is their family right here. And Sean and April were part of my L group. Now, let me tell you this. Because of commitment and determination and faith, generations have been changed because of that right there. Church, what kind of impact could we have? We're called to see and to lead out into transforming people's lives, to being literally the feet of Jesus. I want to take you back just real quick to the movie Saving Private Ryan. Eight men were tasked with going into battle to save one. I want you to watch what happens.
The tank buster, sir, P-51s.
Angels on our shoulders.
What, sir?
James. Earn this.
Thank you.
family is with me today. They wanted to come with me. To be honest with you, I wasn't sure how I'd feel coming back here. Every day, I think about what you said to me that day on the bridge. I've tried to live my life the best I could. I hope that was enough. I hope that at least in your eyes, I've earned what all of you have done for me.
James. Captain John H. Miller.
Ryan. He's struggling. He's having a hard time wrestling with the fact of was the sacrifice that was made for him, was it worth it? You know, Jesus willingly went into battle. Not just for one, but he went into battle for all. And church, that's what we're called to. We're called to go into battle, to rescue one person at a time. The question for us is, are we living up to that? For me, and I hope it is for you, the only reasonable response to the one that gave his all for me is for me to give my all to him. Will you bow your heads? Close your eyes. Christians, I hope that you will carry these characteristics out of here today. Make them part of your life. Be committed. Be determined. And live with faith. Maybe there's some of you and you're here or you're watching on the other side of a screen and there's something happening in your heart. Like you're starting to realize right now that maybe you're the one. You're the one that Jesus went into battle to save. And you're right, he is. He went into battle to save you. Jesus Christ, the risen Son of God, the one who was sinless, the one who left heaven and came here and walked among us, lived a sinless, perfect life. He went to the cross. Jesus, he went to the cross and he died. His blood was shed for my sin and for your sin, for my shame and for your shame. But here's the deal. Here's the message, okay? He didn't stay on the cross. He didn't stay dead. The tomb is empty and he is risen. He is alive today. And the reason why he's alive is so that he can place his life right inside of yours. So I want to ask you, has there ever been a time in your life when you've said yes to him? If not, what's holding you back? Come on, say yes to Jesus. Say yes to him. You might say, well, how do I do that? I don't know how. That very same guy that I talked about, his name was Paul. He wrote in a few verses down in that very same chapter, this is what he said, that if anyone who would confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in their heart that God raised him from the dead. This is what he said. He says, they will be saved. And so that's what you can do today, wherever you are, with your heads bowed, your eyes are closed, but your heart is open to God. Why don't you just confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord? Why don't you just have this conversation with him right now? Just say this. Just say his name, Jesus. And ask him, Jesus, will you please forgive me of my sins? Jesus, will you make me right with God? Will you please come into my life? I'm turning, tell him this, I'm turning from my life of sin to a life surrendered to you, Jesus. I'm all yours. I'm all yours. I'm placing my faith in you today. Listen, if that was your conversation with Jesus, let me tell you what just happened. He just stepped out of heaven and right into your heart. That was Jesus right there. He just entered into your heart. He just saved you. He just forgave you of your sins. Your life has been changed. And if that was you, if that was your prayer, I want to ask you to do something, okay? Please listen up. If you prayed that prayer with me, I want to ask you, if you will, wherever you are, I want to ask you if you would, just raise your hand right now. Just slip your hand up, wherever it is right now. Just raise it up and hold it up right now. Pastor, I just prayed that prayer. I said yes to Jesus. I said yes to him. Raise it up and hold it up. Hold it up. Those of you that are watching on the other side of a screen, you can do the very same thing. Just raise your hand. And by clicking the links in the chat sections, if you're an online church, click the little hand raised emoji. Come on, you got to tell somebody. You got to tell somebody.
If you just said yes to Jesus, text the number below and say, I said yes. We want to walk through this journey with you. We love you, our online community. We would not be The Lift without you or able to celebrate all the ways the Lord has worked over 15 years. Make sure you text the number down below, I said yes, so that we can walk through this journey with you. We love you and we'll see you next week.